Welcome to the lecture on catalytic organometallics, part 19. Subject of today are, first of all, the Murray reaction. You probably have never heard about that, but it's very interesting and very useful reaction. And one far more renowned reaction, the olefin metathesis, will follow. Okay, so the Murray reaction. Is a ruthenium catalyzed reaction, a pre-coordinated ruthenium catalyst activates an aromatic CH bond. The general scheme of that reaction is this one. So, a substrate with an aromatic substrate with a carbonyl group reacts with an olefin and, as I said, a ruthenium catalyst and as the net result olefin is inserted into a CH bond ortho to the carbonyl functionality. The mechanism of this process so the active ruthenium catalyst is coordinated to the carbonyl group. In the next step, a CH insertion takes place. Then a hydroruthenation of that olefin, presumably with a pre-coordination of olefin to the ruthenium. Reductive elimination will form the CC bond between this and that carbon. And the active ruthenium catalyst goes back into the catalytic cycle, re-enters the catalytic cycle. So let's have a look at a first example. Acetophenone with an ortho methyl group was combined with an allyl silane as catalyst. A ruthenium hydride was used with carbon monoxide and triphenyl phosphines as additional ligands. Just 1% of that ruthenium catalyst is sufficient. Toluene at reflux temperature means 115 degrees, is frequently used. 30 minutes to 2 hours reaction time. Resulting for this case in an alkylation of the second ortho position the TMS group survives that reaction and 97% yield was obtained. For the following structures, I just draw the product. So this is one starting material. And this product was obtained by the Murray reaction. This C-C bond has been formed, obviously, with ortho-methyl styrene as a coupling component, 89% yield. Also, heterocycles can be used as substrates. CH activation then in this position. A vinyl silane applied in this case, giving rise to this product, 93% yield, and a somewhat more complex substrate, here the carbonyl group for the pre-coordination of the ruthenium catalyst. This is the CH bond which is activated, the same vinyl silane, then gave a quantitative yield of this interesting product. Reaction of benzophenone was successful in derivatizing with two ethyl groups, this one and that one. So ethene simply was the reagent, put on with pressure, of course, 96% yield. Another example with a trifluoromethyl group in one ortho position and an ester as the carbonyl functionality. Again, an excellent yield. Next example. With an acetylene as substrate, while the yield in that case was a bit diminished, 83%, nevertheless a nice result, And, well, obviously, a cis addition reaction is the net result of a CH bond to that CC triple bond. Exclusively a cis addition reaction. Well, not only ruthenium complexes are able to catalyze this type of reaction. Just one further example. Such an amide also is able to undergo a muriate type reaction. With norbornene as the olefinic coupling component. And this was achieved, well, a 35% yield with an iridium catalyst, but it was a chiral catalyst, and we achieved an 87% enantiomeric excess. Well, I'm sure that a couple of groups are still working on this enantioselective muriate type reaction. Well, finally, we should compare this type of muriate reaction with palladium catalyzed coupling processes we have in principle discussed before. One substrate and as the olefinic reagent. Acrylic acid butyl, N-butyl ester, with 2% of a palladium 2 catalyst, palladium acetate, for instance, under acidic conditions, paratoluene sulfonic acid and acetic acid, it is possible to get a coupling product is still an olefin. Well, this has something to do with the better hydride elimination step you frequently observe in the palladium chemistry. Thus, the palladium 2 will be reduced essentially to palladium 0, and that is the reason you have to reoxidize to get to the active palladium 2 catalyst again, and therefore, in this case, one equivalent of benzoquinone had to be added that the catalytic cycle can work at all. Okay, nevertheless, nice yield of 85%. Related to the muriate reaction, the process I think that has been also developed at Osaka University in the group of Chatami pyridine has been functionalized ...65% yield while the linear chain here with 93% and 7% the branched one. This has been achieved with, well, about 1% of a ruthenium catalyst. Was a ruthenium cluster. A cluster with three ruthenium atoms and 12 carbon monoxide units. 10 atmosphere pressure, carbon monoxide pressure, 150 degrees, 16 hours, no solvent. So why is this rather strange cluster necessary for that type of reaction? Well, similar to the case before, a pre-coordination plays an important role within that catalytic cycle. So, a ligand exchange takes place . Let's abbreviate that complex with this L12 carbonyl units . Okay, a ligand exchange takes place, one carbon monoxide goes off and one pyridine unit is introduced. So, and in this case, now one ruthenium is in close proximity to that CH bond. That's the reason why you need that kind of cluster. So, one carbon monoxide goes off, unsaturated, coordinatively unsaturated with ruthenium, and there goes with insertion. So, and that hydrogen is bound to those two ruthenium centers. Well, and all the other steps are similar to what we know from other mechanisms. We need a hydroruthenation of that olefin, and in addition, a carbonyl insertion step. And that's it. So, Also in the olefin metathesis, ruthenium catalysts are highly important. So, next subject, olefin metathesis. Well, all of you have already heard about that, and there was a Nobel Prize a couple of years ago for olefin metathesis, but I think you have mainly studied that in terms of inorganic chemistry. Well, let's focus on what you can do that with olefin metathesis in organic synthesis. So, early examples, the earliest examples were found in industry. For instance, this very nice reaction, norbornene, with an aluminum titanium catalyst, gave a polymer. Polynorbornene, an unsaturated polymer, and this was found at DuPont in 1960. Another reaction. Not a polymerization. This pentene reacted with a tungsten catalyst, tungsten hexachloride. Well, in addition, you need that aluminum reagent. Benzene was used as a solvent, ethanol as a co-solvent, reflux temperature, and the formation of butene and hexene was observed, and as it turned out, this is an equilibrium process, and the final equilibrium was reached with 50% of its starting material, 25% of this, and 25% of that, while some minor amounts of the cis olefins might have also been observed. This reaction was called olefin metathesis, and in general, we understand under olefin metathesis a reaction like that, so the substituents at the olefin are exchanged, but as it turned out, well, it is the exchange not of the substituents but of these carbene units actually. So the mechanism was much in debate. In 1971, the French chemist Chauvin suggested that metal carbene complexes are involved and, well, with a reaction, they react with olefins, forming metallocyclobutanes, as intermediate, and that this step is reversible. Well, also this mechanism was in debate, but is finally accepted as key steps in the mechanism of those olefin metathesis processes we know. Important types of olefin metathesis . Well, first of all, this process, the polymerization, and up there with that formation of the polynorbonene, we have one of the most prominent examples. This is abbreviated with this ROMP for ring opening metathesis. Polymerization. For organic chemists interested in synthesis, the ring closing metathesis is the most interesting. Abbreviated as RCM. Well, the metathesis is generally an equilibrium reaction, as we have already learned. And here is that intriguing idea that if you eliminate, for instance, ethylene or propene, if you have an additional methyl group here, then you have a very low boiling product and you can rid of it from that equilibrium and you can run the reaction to completion by that way. So, as I said, RCM is the abbreviation. This is the ring closing metathesis. Depending on the catalyst and on the concentration you apply, you can, of course, use this type of substrates also for a polymerization process. Finally, also this process combining two olefins in a cross metathesis CM for cross metathesis. And in that case, again, ethylene is eliminated. This is highly interesting. In that case, the question arises, how can you achieve a selectivity for the cross metathesis rather than coupling this or that with itself, of course. Well, nice selectivities can be achieved. We will see that later on. So, these are the important types of olefin metathesis. What are the important catalysts in this field? First major breakthrough was achieved in 1990 by famous chemist Schrock, who concentrated on molybdenum and tungsten catalysts. Well, he started with tantalum, if I remember that correctly, and one of the first catalysts that was brought to the market, you could by that was molybdenum imido alkylidene with this structure. So here's H3 group, and we have two trifluoromethyl groups, and the same here. As I said, a major breakthrough, because this catalyst is very active, structurally well-defined, one of the first well-defined catalysts in this field. But on the other hand, while it's not that easy to synthesize, that diminishing the widespread application, and it is rather oxygen and moisture sensitive, and has quite a lot of limitation in terms of functional groups which are tolerated by that catalyst. Nevertheless, it is exceptionally active and, in some cases still used today. In 1992, Grubbs, as another major player in this field, introduced a ruthenium catalyst. Which is much easier to synthesize. Somewhat less active than the other one. Well, and Grubbs, Schrock, and Chauvin were the three who received the Nobel Prize together. Well, this is less sensitive, not as active as the other one, but in 1995, a similar catalyst was introduced. Even more easy to synthesize with tricyclohexyl phosphines as ligand. And this one is then meanwhile called the first generation Grubbs catalyst. It has clearly higher activity as this one. Well, sometimes it's also described as one of the first generation catalysts. We could call it the zero generation Grubbs catalyst. Well, and if there is a first generation Grubbs catalyst, there's certainly a second generation. Came up in 1999. Second generation, yeah, which then had an NHC ligand. You all know these ligands. Derived from these stable carbenes. Here with mesityl units. The first one was unsaturated here. We work both with or without double bond in this position. One ruthenium. And all the other substituents are the same as with the first generation catalyst. This one is stable. Against moisture and air, and additional stabilization was achieved with, well, a small change here, phosphine-free catalysts, I think it's very nice how one can observe the development, improvement of the catalysts. How do you get to phosphine free? Metathesis ligands. Well, okay, you need to offer an additional coordinating ligand, which one is fastened to the phenyl group, an isopropyl oxy group, and those catalysts, well, also introduced in 1999, are nowadays called the Hoveda-Grubbs catalysts. Not to forget that Siegfried Blechert at Berlin University was also very much involved in this type of catalysts. So let's discuss the mechanism for the ring closing metathesis in somewhat more detail. So, the ring closing metathesis. What we need is the transition metal carbene complex with or without an additional ligand here. But after going through the first cycle of a reaction, you will have just the simple CH2 carbene complex as active catalyst. So, a 2+2 cyclo addition step will take place, and we can imagine that preferentially the one with the metal at the less hindered position will evolve. And this is the structure. So, the reversed reaction, and it is a reversible reaction, well, will either break these bonds or the other one. The result is always the same. That means this is an intermediate in the process, but it's not productive, somehow a dead end. But nevertheless, it is reversible and it will fall apart again. If the less favored 2+2 cycloaddition product is formed, this one, then a reverse reaction might occur, but now we have a chance for a productive step within that catalytic cycle. Ethene is eliminated. And this intermediate. Now, again, two plus two cycloaddition. And a cycloreversion will form the observed ring closed product, and The transition metal carbene complex will re-enter the catalytic cycle. And now, as you see, with that simple methylene carbene attached. This ring closing metaphysis has, well, significantly changed the way we approach complex target molecules in planning the synthesis of these molecules. Simply, you can imagine that, for instance, for a dihydrofuran with several additional substituents, this is such an intriguing plan for synthesizing such a structure . Well, of course, this is less impressive, but explains very nicely the idea, the importance for the synthesis. Let's have a look at some more impressive examples. For instance, let's assume we have as the target molecule this structure. This is an interesting structure because, for perfume industry, these are important ingredients. So, within the olefin metathesis, still an olefin is formed, but we don't care. We can hydrogenate that olefin, and that means we could have an olefin in whatever position we want. We could hydrogenate that to get this target molecule. So, for instance, one synthesis that has been done successfully is this one. With 4% of first generation Grubbs catalyst, abbreviate that with first generation ruthenium catalyst, under high dilution, a 79% yield was obtained. Of this macrocycle as a mixture of the cis and the trans isomer, but since we want to hydrogenate that double bond, we just don't care in that case, yeah? And just the hydrogenation, for instance, a palladium catalyst, palladium on charcoal, will deliver nicely this product. So next examples. E abbreviates an ester functionality. And these substrates, as you know, are easily synthesized from starting from malonates. Just 10 minutes with a low concentration, about 1 or 2% of an active ruthenium or molybdenum catalyst. Will deliver this functionalized cyclopentane as a product with second generation ruthenium catalyst and also with the Schrock molybdenum catalyst. The yield is quantitative after just 10 minutes reaction time. Somewhat more sterically hindered with an additional methyl group here, and on that side it is elongated by one methylene group, but additionally also here that methyl group. We need then a longer reaction time, 90 minutes, the olefin metathesis, ring closing metathesis, will deliver this product. With ruthenium catalyst, it was obtained with 90% yield, and the molybdenum catalyst with 52%. So it seems to be that should always favor a ruthenium catalyst. This is unfortunately not the case. Next example proves that Schrock's molybdenum catalysts, quite a lot of cases, are superior, not in terms of handling them, but in terms of a final result, 31% with a ruthenium catalyst and 93% with Schrock's catalyst. Another example for molybdenum catalyzed reaction. You might guess how this substrate has been synthesized. Should remember that from the preceding semester. Molybdenum catalyst, dichloromethane at room temperature, and the Evans enolate product. Will lead with 97% yield to this rather interesting chiral functionalized cyclopentene. And well, you can hydrolyze that off and will have here this group in the oxidation state of a carboxylic acid, or you might reduce that to an aldehyde, or you reduce it to the oxidation state of a primary alcohol simply. Another example, typical structure. This one with a ruthenium catalyst. Cyclization in this case leads to a 7-membered ring isolated with 95% yield, having an additional CH2 group here, homoallylic ether will give an 8-membered ring, still with 95% yield, one CH2 group more, giving a 9-membered ring, then the yield goes down beyond 50%, but nevertheless still a useful reaction. The first step in the synthesis of the substrate which has been applied or tested in the metathesis reaction. So with a palladium zero catalyst, one atmosphere pressure of carbon monoxide and allylic alcohol. So what will happen? We have discussed these reactions before. Palladium zero. And there goes an oxidative addition to the carbon iodide bond, carbopalladation, as a 5-exo trig process. And then, before reacting with that olefin, the alkyl palladium is intercepted by carbon monoxide insertion reaction, an acyl palladium complex, which reacts with the allylic alcohol, giving a nice yield. Of 5-product, which then is cyclized with first generation ruthenium complex. Final product, again as a mixture of a cis and trans isomer, was obtained in up to 78% yield for that overall yield for that two-step process. Another interesting substrate starting substrate with a structure of that highly unsaturated acetal. Again, the first generation catalyst. Sorry, it was the second one with the tricyclohexyl phosphines. So, second. Yes, here the same. So we won't get the cyclization here. This will react with that one, this with that. So, and as the final result, a spirocyclic acetal is formed with 90% yield. Same catalyst. The second olefinic moiety offered through that allylic silane. Second generation Grubbs ruthenium catalyst. And again, an excellent yield of 95%. In this case, you exclusively have, of course, the cis configuration at that olefin. But again, keep in mind with macro cycles, you generally have a mixture of a cis and trans isomers. You can avoid these mixture of cis and trans isomers if you change from the olefin metathesis to the alkyne metathesis, which will be also subject of tomorrow. Final reaction for today is a cross metathesis with the same second generation ruthenium catalyst. What is important for that cross metathesis to be successful is that you use an electron poor olefin and an electron-rich olefin, second-generation ruthenium catalyst, and what you will get then is also the elimination of ethylene. Let's count the carbons. 5 carbons delivered by that substrate. Right. So, a 99% yield was obtained, and the stereoselectivity, the trans in favor of the cis olefin, was better than 22:1. So, tomorrow, as announced, we will talk about the alkyne metathesis and also a bit of a metathesis where you combine one alkyne moiety and one olefin moiety. Thank you for listening. See you tomorrow.